I take great pleasure in declaring open again the Standing Committee on Legal and Social Issues and our public inquiry into the use of cannabis in Victoria.
So you all know that the referendum very narrowly lost, with 50.7% of voters opposing the legalisation and 48.4% in support. That's about a 70,000 vote difference. So in our context, that's a very narrow margin. It was all about public health. Not only because we were shifting away from criminalising, but also because of what the legislation would have meant for those vulnerable to harm of cannabis use, young people, people who use regularly or heavily, people with a particular risk factor.
Decision makers and politicians talk about outcomes, but one of the really important things about cannabis policy change is deciding what objectives do people actually value. Do they want to reduce health and social harm? Do they want to reduce arrests? They want to create a new industry. So how people value those different objectives determines how they value the outcomes.
What's the underlying assumptions for the increases in health harms for a light regulation approach?
What we were essentially saying was that there's likely to be some increase in harm, but just because you're going to get more users. And some of the best studies that are just coming out now have shown increases in adult use in US states that have legalised cannabis, and even increase in 12 to 17 year olds who have also increased since legalisation.
What do you think that any reduction or any profit we might have by increasing the education, reforming the education in the way that we have learned from the data or from all the materials or substance abuse that we have seen?
The evidence from alcohol and tobacco, if education is an addition to a commercial market, that's actually not that effective. The evidence evaluation of those stuff suggests that if the cannabis law reform in this case would be highly commercial market with commercial operators, they have their own ways of going against that and marketing and so on. That's not to say education is not worth trying. That's to say that it's important, but you know, the impact of that education will be important on what policy change you're intending to do.
What was the reasoning for the 20 age point to be made in the legislation for use?
20 was settled on is both closer to the age where less harm would occur, but also pragmatic based on who was actually accessing using cannabis. Because you've got to remember, we don't want to exclude those who would most benefit from the legislation not to be covered by it. So they don't get the protections. They would essentially be turning once again to the black market, where they miss out on the health interventions that you can get through a regulated approach.
Aren't they going to be doing that anyway under 20 years of age? Isn't that just an arbitrary figure that is counterproductive to what you're trying to achieve?
I guess in an ideal world, we want to delay the onset, the start of use as long as possible, right?
Why?
And I guess, because it's most harmful for younger brains.
Thank you.
So that's why.
So my question's around the referendum process. In retrospect, did it set back the legalisation movement having the referendum fail? Would you recommend that as a way of going to legalisation?
I would say a majoritarian vote probably isn't the best way to create public health legislation. So evidence using your elected process is probably a better way to go.
The New Zealand referendum would have definitely been successful if they had limited it to decriminalisation, and that would actually have been quite a good gain, because it would have stopped the thing that I think is quite important, and that's it would have prevented arresting of people and the implications that has on the rest of their lives in terms of having a criminal conviction.
We know convictions actually, after decades of evidence, do nothing to deter use. We know that decriminalisation and legal changes from Portugal to your own neighbours in ACT haven't resulted in massive uptake in substance use. and particularly where a careful health model has been adopted.
We very much appreciate the work that you put into providing submissions to us, but also the openness of which you've joined us today. So thank you very much.